Now let's look at a totally different fatty tumor. This is from a large mass from the retroperitoneum of an adult. So right away we can see it's a hypercellular tumor of atypical spindle cells. In this case, they're kind of arranged in fascicles with some myxoid, blue myxoid background. So a hypercellular spindle cell tumor, it's got some necrosis, and we're in the retroperitoneum of an adult. The first, second, and third thing on my differential diagnosis is going to be dedifferentiated liposarcoma. A high-grade sarcoma in the retroperitoneum of adult, dedifferentiated liposarcoma until proven otherwise, in my opinion. Other people may disagree, but that's the way I do. I think of it because dedifferentiated liposarcomas are relatively common as sarcomas go in adults in the retroperitoneum, okay? But in this case, we can tell also that the answer is dedifferentiated liposarcoma because we have a high-grade sarcoma plus right next to it, we have well-differentiated liposarcoma. And there are three main things we look for in well-differentiated liposarcoma. Well-differentiated liposarcoma were in the extremities, we would call it atypical lipomatous tumor. It's the same tumor, we just give it a different name when it's in the extremities because it has a better prognosis there. But the three things I like to see is mature fat, usually with variable size, large, medium, and small size adipocytes, fibrous bands in between, and that's usually this dense, hyalinized sclerotic collagen, and then scattered hyperchromatic atypical cells. And all of those components can vary, and not every case has all of them. But in this case, this case is reading the textbook, so to speak, and it has hyperchromatic atypical cells scattered here that are not as dramatically atypical in this case as in some, with this sclerotic collagen and then the mature fat. So when we have a well-diff liposarcoma with any high-grade sarcoma component, then by definition, that's dedifferentiated liposarcoma. The dedifferentiated component can have a wide range of different morphologic features. A lot of them look like undifferentiated pleomorphic sarcoma, bizarre, atypical spindle cells with no fat, no lipoblasts, nothing. But a subset can actually have lipoblasts. In the old days, we said that this was not allowed, but now we recognize that a small subset of dedifferentiated liposarcomas actually do have pleomorphic lipoblasts, and this is called homologous lipogenic differentiation or homologous lipoblastic differentiation if you want to be fancy. But I think it's important to study dedifferentiated liposarcoma because like I said, they're relatively common among sarcomas, and they can have such dramatic differences in morphology from case to case and even within the same patient's tumor. So I'm going to show you in this case, we've got areas with elongated vessels and atypical cells and a myxoid background, kind of resembling myxofibrosarcoma. We have areas with lipoblasts. We also, let me show you a different slide, same patient, same tumor, but just a different section. In this area, we have a dramatic pleomorphism and bizarre pleomorphic lipoblasts, again with that myxoid background. And this is also a good reminder that any form of liposarcoma can have myxoid background, not just myxoid liposarcoma. You can have myxoid background in a dedifferentiated liposarcoma, in well-differentiated liposarcoma, and in pleomorphic liposarcoma. So the presence of blue myxoid change in a liposarcoma does not prove what type of liposarcoma it is. I've got a whole long video about liposarcomas you can go see on my YouTube channel, and it even has a Spanish translation to the subtitles. You can go click a link down below and see that. So again, just to highlight the wide variation in morphologic appearance from location to location in dedifferentiated liposarcoma. But the real reason I wanted to show you this case, because I've shown and posted many dedifferentiated liposarcomas before in videos and digital slides on Kiko. Oh wait, there's one other pattern. Here's myxoid change, but look how bland. This area kind of looks a little bit like myxoid liposarcoma. Myxoid liposarcoma, though, is very rare in the retroperitoneum. It's usually in the extremities. If I think I see myxoid liposarcoma in the retroperitoneum, it's almost always going to end up actually being a D-diff liposarcoma or maybe a well-diff with myxoid change, depending on the cellularity and mitotic activity. Or I've not encountered this in real life, but there are cases of this, a person that has myxoid liposarcoma, say, in their thigh, and then they get a metastasis to the retroperitoneum, because true myxoid liposarcomas can metastasize to weird, unusual locations. So this is just another area. Again, this is the same tumor as the last two slides, just a different area. And this looks very different than the previous two slides I showed you. But now, the real reason I wanted to show you is because this is a fascinating and unusual pattern that I only get to see occasionally. So here we have these whorled, swirled areas of spindle cells, again with a little bit of myxoid background. So these, I think, fall into the category of what's called meningothelial whorls, because it kind of resembles the whorling that you can see in a meningioma. And in this case, we're getting whorls of the dedifferentiated liposarcoma, so meningothelial whorl pattern, which is a well-described but relatively uncommon morphologic pattern that can be seen in a dedifferentiated, and also it's sometimes even in a well-differentiated liposarcoma, but usually dedifferentiated. And this case was really fascinating to me. There's two reasons I like it. Three, maybe. One, I like to have the swirly, whirly pattern that you see in meningiomas and in perineuriomas. I just like that pattern morphologically for some reason. The other one is that one of the very first papers I participated in as a resident was about dedifferentiated liposarcoma with meningothelial whorls. So this case is near and dear to my heart because of that memory. And then also, look what's in the middle of these meningothelial whorls. Each whorl has a little fiber of skeletal muscle in the middle of it. And I cannot really explain why that's happening. I am not sure if it is because the tumor infiltrated skeletal muscle and then swirled around each fiber, or if the tumor is actually differentiating into mature skeletal muscle fibers. I kind of suspect it's from infiltration and then the whorling developed around the fibers. I have never seen this particular pattern in a dedifferentiated liposarcoma before. I just thought it was fascinating, and I have been saving this up to share at some point in the future, and because it was kind of a special case, and I wanted to share it with all of you. And what's more, look at the background. For some reason, you get all of these kind of bland, multivacculated lipoblasts filling the background space, almost resembling the pattern of brown fat that you see in hibernoma. So what a bizarre, crazy tumor with so many different patterns. So just enjoy all these morphologic patterns for the sake of their interesting nature, but also remember that any sort of tumor you see in the retroperitoneum, always keep dedifferentiated liposarcoma in your differential diagnosis. And if you're having difficulty, you can do testing for MDM2. I prefer using FISH, but some people use immunohistochemistry. Just be careful that you can have false positive staining with immunostains. So you can use molecular testing for MDM2 amplification to help support the diagnosis on a small needle biopsy or in difficult cases.